Welcome to our literacy forum. We are recording live tonight. Thank you, HCAM, for being here, and especially thank you tonight because given our impending winter storm, I think that many people are cuddled up at home, and hopefully this is giving you an opportunity to watch the panel live. But we are so delighted to be here tonight. You can see all of the educators sitting here with me who care deeply about literacy, and I'm especially proud to be introducing them and to have the opportunity to work with all of these educators and to be part of the planning of tonight's evening. So I'll start by introducing Dr. Carol Cavanaugh, who has been instrumental in bringing together this presentation, Lauren Dubot, the principal from Century School, Ann Carver, principal at elementary school. You notice that I'm introducing them in order of grade level. And Vanessa Villello, the principal of Hawkins School, and thank you for hosting us here tonight. I'd ask each of the principals to introduce their staff members and the roles that they play in each of the buildings, and then we'll get into our presentation. So, Lauren, why don't you start?
Thank you. So with me tonight, I have first grade teacher Jennifer Kane. She's also a co-teacher who supports a reading classroom, meeting needs of a variety of students. We also have Deb Moriarty, a literacy coach, who is actually shared between Center and Elmwood School. So her role is to support instruction, support teachers in their adjustment to practice to meet literacy needs. So thank you for joining us.
Good evening, thank you. I have with me Leslie Pryor, who is a second grade teacher in a general education classroom. Beth Callahan is our team chair. Beth is actually shared between Hopkins and Elmwood, so she splits her time between the two schools. And Mary Zambuto is a third grade teacher, a co-teacher, in, and Mary's also a learning specialist. So thank you. Vanessa.
And joining me tonight, I have Janine Stefancic, who is one of our learning specialists at Hopkins School and also does a lot of work around reading to support classroom teachers and learning specialists at Hopkins.
And I have the pleasure of introducing our middle school staff. We have with us Carrie Connor, who is a literacy coach, and Kelly Major, who's a learning specialist, both from Hopkins Middle School.
So what we are wanting to impress upon you is that these folks work together. And the presentation tonight is to tell you the story of what happens once the children enter our schools and the supports that they have all the way along the way to prepare them for what they're going to be needing to be able to learn and do at the middle school. And as we started thinking about what we wanted to be able to share tonight, that would actually be the next slide. It was really important because we have so many transitions for our students for you to know how closely we work together as administrators but also as teachers across buildings. So this is what our focus is going to be on tonight. This is what you're going to learn. You're going to learn about our literacy instruction, and that includes writing. So when we talk about literacy, we're talking about reading and we're talking about writing. You're going to learn about what kinds of assessments do we do, what kinds of common assessments, how do we look at assessments, and what do we do with the information that we gain from the assessments that we take. Intervention practices, and how these are varied and individualized based on the learning needs of students. And finally, what are some things that you can do at home to support your developing reader? Tonight is supposed to be a time of really educating the community about the variety of programs available and the different stages of reading development. And so I will hand it over, I think, to you, Carol.
To Lauren.
Hand it over to Lauren.
Thank you. Thank you. So areas that we will share with you tonight and focus upon are areas that cross buildings. So it's not something that happens only at Center School, only at Elmwood, only at Hopkins School. As children transition through the grades, how that looks will also transition so it matches
readers at that level. You will hear about foundations. Some of you may have heard that already. And while we are building a reading foundation, you will hear about this approach, this program called Foundations. You will also hear about reading instruction. Foundations is not the only approach we have to address literacy needs, but what does that look like? Whole group, small group. You might recall back to your days of what reading looked like in the classroom, what you experienced, and it is different today. We're doing a much better job of targeting individual needs and focusing on individual instructional approaches. You will also hear about SRSD. That stands for what it says here, that self-regulated writing strategy development. Our goal is to provide children with tools to empower them to be skilled writers. And providing them these tools as they transition through the grades, it will also increase their independence, their confidence. You will see wonderful samples ranging from Center School through Hopkins about how children are developing as writers. So we are thrilled to be able to share our approach as it transcends through the grades. And Jen's going to chat about some other aspects of literacy.
Thank you, Lauren. This is a great slide because it really shows just how hands-on and engaging we can make phonemic awareness at Center School. There are so many different activities that we can engage the kids in. Phonemic awareness is different than phonics. Phonemic awareness is the ability to manipulate sounds in a word and change words up and listen for syllables and listen for rhymes. And gone are the days where you sit at your table and you just write down rhyming words. In room 11, for example, in my classroom, we are sorting vowel sounds into vowel owls. And as the phonemic awareness program moves along, we're finding pictures that rhyme with a certain sound. Kids are always up and moving. We like to have our kids active and up on their feet and excited about learning in first grade. There are so many ways that we can put phonemic awareness in during the day, like find a buddy first thing in the morning that has the matching rhyming card, or match up a different vowel from across the room. Of phonetic skills, and I can really see a carryover into their reading attack and their reading attack strategies and their writing. What I like about this is that phonics isn't just the old drill and kill like we might have had when we were in elementary school. One of the things that the kids love to use during this program are the letter tiles. And here's one of my students making all different types of words with ship, and they're making junk, and they're learning that digraphs really aren't just two letters, it's really one letter combined, and they just
So Foundations is new to us in Hockington. It's not a new program, but something as we looked at our approach to literacy and address a need that we had. We needed to do more with phonemic awareness and all the other skills that are listed here. This year, it is kindergarten, first grade, and second grade, where it is implemented across all classrooms. As Jen mentioned, a component is phonemic awareness. Those are manipulating sounds. Think of the nursery rhymes, the rhymes in cars. Those are important skills for children to have so they can hear differences in sounds, which then when we get to phonics, they will know it's a different letter that makes that sound. It also has phonics as a component. We definitely send and build on that, where we then are attaching letters and sounds to the what we're hearing. High frequency words, we have students, those basic words that you are familiar with, I, the, ma, me, my. Reading fluency, we're building up that capacity to read like we talk. Vocabulary, as you're building words, is that a real word, is it a nonsense word? There are a variety of exposures to different aspects. Comprehension, as we're building sentences, does it make sense? Well, tell me what that means. handwriting. At the lower level, I'm going to say, this is huge. We are being quite sticklerish, if I can create such a word, on how you build your letters, what your stroke looks like, and having much attention to that. So as children write, because it will increase the writing demands, they are more comfortable with it, and they can form those letters with ease. So we'll use short pencils. We talk about strokes. Many of you might have heard skyline, grass line at home. That means they are cognizant of where they're supposed to start their letters and how they're making those letters. And spelling. I know I have a lot of questions this year from parents. Doesn't my child have a spelling list? Foundations approaches spelling every day through hands-on lessons where then it's carried over. We're not studying a list for 1 week where then it's never brought back to the long-term memory and we can't apply it later. We are building spelling capacity, if you will, so that whenever we need to conjure up that word, we know how to spell it from our patterns and how we have learned to build such words. Where this extends into second grade, Anne's going to talk a little bit more about this program.
Thank you. So what you see in this slide is an example of, there's a name tag at the top. Each of the students have a name tag. There are the letters are written across the alphabet letters. The vowels are one color, consonants are another. And students, there are key pictures that go with each of the letter sounds. So students in early grades are learning that letters, they have a key picture, it's called a keyword, and they might say things, for example, A, apple, A. And kids really learn to associate a picture with a sound and a letter. And this is a nice example of combining some writing that's happening through SRSD, but it's in a Foundations journal. They're using the lined paper that goes along with Foundations. One of the things that I'm really excited about, because as a classroom teacher, penmanship was really important to me, and what I see kids understanding, as Lauren already pointed out, is children know where to put the pencil. So when they're starting to write creatively, kids are sometimes sort of stymied by not having the ability to write things in the right way, to actually form words. When they're taught how to use penmanship, then this creative process is a little bit simpler because they're not fretting over, how do I make a B? They learn those things and then they can apply it. So this is something that will come up again when we talk about second grade and third grade SRSD, but this is an example of some color coding of some writing. Foundations, the thing that's very exciting for both Center School and Elmwood School is that skills are taught in kindergarten, and then when they get to first grade, they're going to start hearing the same language with additional skills, and they're going to be understanding that's a trick word. That's we don't use this word sight word in Foundations, using plain line to identify where you're going to put your pencil, knowing that this is a trick word or a glued sound or a digraph. Those are things that once kindergarten has given the students a start, they'll see it again in first grade, then they get to second grade. This year has been a little bit more challenging with second grade Foundations because the teachers in second grade are tasked with picking up in second grade and they didn't have the Foundations in K-1s prior to it. So my second grade teachers are really excited about having students come to them with sort of a base of understanding, and then they'll be able to take that and move forward. That all of the skills that are taught in Foundations are systematic and they build on one another. There's several units, I think at least 10 or 12, 16 units of instruction, and each unit builds on the one before it, and it's just some very exciting work that's happening. And this is Vanessa's slide.
So by the time students get to fourth and fifth grade, many students have already established their skills for decoding. And certainly now that students are coming up to Hopkins with this common language, it's wonderful that we use a program called Just Words, which is very closely associated. So a smaller population of students, once they get into Hopkins School, we can identify through our assessments that we'll talk about a little later, still have needs to learn more decoding skills, to build their accuracy for word reading. And Just Words is a program that we utilize that fits with Foundations and continues the same explicit multisensory instruction in a very systematic way that follows the instruction that students will have gotten in Foundations and continues it forward for students who need more time to master those skills specifically.
Okay. So I'm Deb Moriarty, the literacy coach for Center and Elmwood Schools. This is a new position. My job is to support the teachers as they teach the kids reading in the classroom. What I want to talk about is what are the teachers doing in some of those small groups. In terms of our research-based reading instruction, they're looking at the five main components of reading and then differentiating their instruction to support the needs of their students. Sometimes the groups may be based on levels of reading, sometimes they're based on interest, sometimes they're based on strategy or skill need. So they're looking at their readers in the classroom during their whole group instruction and then deciding how they want to pull them in their groups. When they're pulling them in their groups, these are some of the things they may be touching upon, which have already been talked about and taught in your whole group session. So they will dip back into phonemic awareness skills. Okay, again, thinking about how sounds make up words, which are the phonemes that the kids need to manipulate. Looking at syllables and how to break down syllables, which then, of course, as they move into harder text and multisyllabic words, will help them at the base. Okay, then they can also support the phonics in small group work. This is where kids who are getting whole group foundations, but sometimes they need a little more. This will be where, again, we're pulling those groups to do more phonics instruction, which, of course, in the primary grades, you're looking at a lot of decoding and trying to figure out those tricky words as they come to them in text. Okay? The overarching purpose of all the reading we're doing with kids is, of course, comprehension instruction. Okay? So, in addition to any type of word attack skills that we're giving them, they have to understand that comprehension is what reading is all about. So at the same time that we're teaching some of these skills in small groups, we're also always layering on comprehension discussions, as well as teaching for those strategies of how do proficient readers understand and make sense of text. Okay? In addition to that, there's the skill set of what a fluent reader sounds like. So obviously teachers are modeling this every single day when they do read aloud, shared reading. But they will also pull small groups of kids to give them some attack skills on how to be a fluent reader. Fluency not only incorporates your rate of reading, but it also has to do with prosody, your word accuracy, as well as intonation. And then, of course, we layer in vocabulary instruction where kids are constantly learning new words as they're reading. And how do they use context within stories or texts to figure out new words that they're coming across? Okay. So again, those are the five main components we're looking at. We teach these all in whole group, and then as needs are seen, teachers are pulling in small groups to touch upon any areas of these bigger pieces. Okay. So this slide here talks a little bit about your typical, I can move over here so I'm not blocking that, your kind of typical characteristics of reading behaviors that we see with kids, okay? We decided to just earmark a couple of particular grades here, not every single one. So when we think about kindergarten, which is our early emergent readers, okay, what are we looking for reading behaviors for them to master? Of course, they have to have concepts about print. They need to know that the directionality of text goes left to right. They need to understand what a return sweep is, which is when you get to the end of a line of text, you know to come back to the left of the next line to continue reading. Okay. They have to know their consonant sounds. They're working in kindergarten with foundations now. They're getting those. They're adding on vowels, long and short sounds of all of those. They're learning to decode, and in kindergarten, in our primary grades, they learn to decode CDC words by tapping them out. So they're using a kinesthetic process to understand how to hear those sounds and figure words out. Okay, CDC words are consonant, vowel, consonant words, which typically follow our generalizations in phonics that the vowel would have a short sound. Okay, so they're learning some of those generalizations about words. Okay. As well as, again, and we mentioned in the foundations piece, that foundations call them trick words. Kind of typically, we've always referred to them as high frequency or sight words. Again, the word of. Okay, those common words that come up in our text as we're reading, And in Funimation, they do refer to them as the trip words. The kids need to know them in a snap. Okay, so in kindergarten, we hope that by the end of the year, they've mastered 25 of the most frequent trick words. Okay. And we're always, again, even in kindergarten, working on comprehension. They need to be able to retell and recall important information from text, whether it's fiction or nonfiction. At the end of second grade, so a jump now, we now have layered on not just long vowels with a silent e, perhaps, but now we're looking at vowel teams in the middle of words. Okay. They're looking at two-syllable words, multisyllabic words, and how to break those words down into their syllables to then attack them. We're up to now with their trick words. Over 100 sight words should be in their repertoire. Continuing, stories now are longer that they're reading. We're still holding them to the comprehension of being able to retell or recount these stories that they're reading. We do add in second grade the deeper meaning. When we talk about what that central message is, or lesson or moral, we're talking about what the theme of a story is. So here's where they have to really start inferring while they're reading. Okay? And of course, by the end of second grade, we're asking that they're able to, on the fly, which is when they're actively reading text, being able to use multiple sources of information, meaning that they can use meaning cues, structure cues, and visual cues at the same time in order to make sense of text, and that all the cues are coming together to support proficient reading. Okay. So now we'll have our next slide on grades 4 and 5, and Carrie will
Hi, Carrie Connor, middle school. But I am fortunate to be able to talk about grade 4, our next benchmark year. In grade 4, it really is a transitional year for the kids because reading starts to slow down and a lot of times people get nervous. And it's just slowing down because they're developing layers of strategies and incorporating so many more things when they're reading. And one of the most important things to notice is the flexible decoders. In those early years, you're hearing a lot about tapping out and word chunks and all of these other ways. But now we're reading a longer text. And students have to be able to decode rapidly, and they have to have a lot of different strategies to attack that text. So that is something that makes fourth grade a pivotal year in reading, because we have these longer texts, longer sentences, bigger words, and what are all these kids going to do with them? They have to be able to do that decoding. It's our job as teachers in the grade 4 and moving higher is to do a lot more work with comprehension and the different types of comprehension. You start hearing inferential, predicting, literal. Now we're doing a lot more of that, and we do direct instruction so that these kids are ready when they get to see Kelly and I up at the middle school. They are encountering text that has vocabulary that's rich, that's content specific. It's new for them. What is a hypothesis? Oh my goodness, it's a big new fancy word. We have to understand it and have make meaning out of it. And then using text features. It's the first time where you're seeing maybe, oh, you have to answer a question, but the answer's in a graph? What? That's just not pretty on the page. No, it's actually information, kids, and let's use it. When we hop to grade 6, where they get the benefit of meeting Kelly and myself, they're now in content area reading. There's not so much reading group. It's we're going to do reading through content. And we have these amazing social studies texts that have primary sources in the text box. And we have to show the kids that there's so much rich knowledge there. So again, they may not be going through books like you saw them plowing through books in the primary grade, but what they're plowing through is so much deeper and so much richer. And it is our job as educators in the middle school to show them all the things that they can mine out of those textbooks through their diagrams and their graphs and their pictures. And guess what? All of those three things I just said offer a completely different type of information. And what is it I have to look at when I need to answer a specific question? And that's our task when they come to meet us. I love doing this with my students because I work with a lot of students in reading. And they have been spending years learning, we all know, what the two sounds of C can make. It can k or s. Oh, but you came to the middle school? Yeah, when you see a C-I in the middle school, it says ch. And you're like, what? Yep, drop the English language. We throw in these little mysteries to you. And so we talk a lot of ancient, or TU saying a ch sound, and the kid's like, Mrs. Connor, really? I'm like, I know, this is what it's like. So we spend a lot of time working with these complex relationships. In simple language, we say they're exceptions, because they have learned that I says it or I. And now we're saying, no, it doesn't, but it's me. It says, ch. Guess what? It doesn't make any sense to them. And that translates into the next one. And then obviously, you guys all know this because you're readers, that as the text gets more complex, maybe the vocabulary isn't as complex as they're dealing with a compound complex sentence. And there's conjunctions, and there's commas, and there's hyphens, and you're like, oh, what am I doing? And that is our job, that when they come to us, we're like, this text isn't that hard. We have to show you all the mysteries that are here and unlock them for you. And that's the benchmark of grade six. So you've heard a lot about reading, and I'll speak for myself growing up a long time ago, that reading groups were you all sat together and you read round robin. Round robin reading means I read, you read, you read, you read, and we all take a turn. Reading has progressed a lot. Guided reading came out in the 1980s. Believe it or not, reading groups started in the late 1800s when teachers started realizing kids weren't reading at the same level. But there's a lot more that we do, and I hope that you hear about these things from your students. We do interactive read-alouds, people making characters, they might have fun. Literature circles, you get a different job when you read. Oh, I'm the artist, I get to draw today, woohoo! Oh, I'm the discussion director, I'm in charge, you know, so makes it more fun. Shared reading, paired reading, performance readings, as low as kindergarten, kids might be acting out something, as high as eighth grade, they may be acting out a scene from a novel in their classroom. It's ways for us to test that they're understanding without them feeling like, oh, I just took another test. But they performed, and oh, they hit all of, I know they were in chapter five, they did a great job. So performance readings are important. I mentioned guiding reading. Those are not whole class, those are groups. And very much to what Deb talked about, they can be groups based on skill, strategy, or interest. But they're small group, they're based on discussions. There's not a lot of pen to paperwork there. It's really important to have students talk about what they read. If they're talking about it, they're making meaning and they're developing a strong love, and that's our goal. Independent reading obviously is important, and that always goes back to writing about reading, which we'll get into when we do SRSD. I have no idea who I'm passing this off to.
So here are some snapshots of various reading happening at Center School. So you'll be able to look at the pictures, but I'm going to focus on the big book. Here we have two children engaged in partner reading. Even as young as kindergarten and first grade, we foster this reading together with a partner. So this is huge. We're sharing, we're taking turns, we're trying to stay together on a page. Sometimes children will want to rush ahead, maybe show off a little bit if they've got those words. So it takes great control to have shared reading work well with children. But you can see we have some smiling faces there, and they're doing a nice job. They might alternate lines, but again, they're working on the experience of reading. The other picture shows some other aspects, but I need to share and let everyone else talk. Jen's going to talk about another aspect of reading.
For the next slide. Yep.
Sorry.
All right. I already passed.
Here you go.
Oh,
Jen's
going to
recap.
Oh, right. Can't talk about what school that worked for.
But I love these slides, and this is one of the big reasons why I love teaching first grade, because in first grade, it is books, 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 and more books. And kids, it's not like, I keep saying, like when we were in school, when you had one book, you had the one reader, and you opened and you read the passage, and that was it for the day. It's not like that anymore. I mean, kids at Center School, I mean, we're reading throughout the day. They have cozy little nooks where they can get down and read. They have little stuffies that you can't really see when he's reading the cutest puppies ever book. You know, you should be reading that with a stuffy. Also, it's amazing that the paired reading and the shared reading here, it eventually gets into like a role playing where a lot of the kids suddenly want to play teacher and they want to model that fluency that they hear us reading to them with. It's an amazing phenomenon that you start seeing around this time of year. This is one of my favorite times during the day. This is one of our guided reading groups. And groups aren't
stagnant. You don't read with Jack and Sally from first grade up until sixth grade. I can't tell you how many times our groups have changed this year because kids are constantly changing. Kids are not one size fits all. Whenever there's a change, whenever there's a need, we're pulling a different group. Round robin really is a thing of the past. I mean, they are whisper reading to me. We're double checking on what someone else just read. We are summarizing what a friend just read. We're asking questions about what might happen on the next page. So it's a real team effort. It's not that one size fits all, let's read a page, and then that's the end of it. It's really an exciting time for them. And it's not a time for that paper activity. Do you remember reading the book and then filling out the page, and there you go, the transaction's completed? This is no paper required. I mean, this is just solid reading for the love of reading. And they have to laugh every time because they have to feel emotion every time because I want them and all teachers want our kids connecting to these books because that's what we do as adults. We read and we want to connect books and that's what we want our kids to do as well. So I can talk forever.
Thank you. So these are some more pictures of students at Elmwood School who are reading. And as you can see in the picture on the left, there's a lot of real genuine joy as the kids discover that they can share something with a good book. And once you've gotten children to get to that point where they make a choice for a book, they share it together, you can see that there's a lot of joy with that. The picture on the right shows someone that has obviously reached a point where she's a little bit more independent in her writing. One of the things that stood out for me here was that what we haven't seen a whole lot of is pictures of teachers. And the question might be, well, what is the teacher doing? These are adorable photographs, but what's the teacher doing? And in this case, I don't even believe that these are necessarily the same room, but what you would see and what I get to see when I go into a classroom is I might say to a teacher, I'll come in this afternoon, I'd like to do an observation of a reading lesson. And this happened to me today. As I came into the room to do my observation, I had a hard time finding the teacher. When I was a first grade teacher, you know, you'd spot me right away. You'd see me in the front of the room, reaching out to the whole group, sort of dishing out a lesson that was meant for all to capture. I was teaching and hoping they were learning. And so as I made my way into a classroom today, I could see that there were groups over here reading. Some students, like this one, are reading a book alone. In other cases, it's children reading to one another. And finally, after some searching, I found the teacher at a table working with four kids. One of the other things that stood out for me is that the entire time I was in this room, approximately 40 minutes, all of the students in the classroom were reading. When I started teaching, as was already mentioned, if I sat at a table with six students, one student read at a time. And the others listened if they could. If they were mature enough to stay focused on the content of the lesson, they followed along with me. And if they didn't, I could give them a little tap and remind them that they were supposed to pay attention. But what I think I really appreciate about instruction today is that kids aren't expected to wait while their friend has their lesson. Kids are expected to guide some of their own instruction. They're directed to make choices of books that are on their level, and then they're given an opportunity to practice. When you think about things that you've wanted to learn, you really get better at those things when you're given a chance to try, to practice. So the teachers are doing a lesson with some students, and he might pass out books to the students, and each of them are reading from a book, and the teacher's leaning in. All the kids are reading, she's leaning in or he's leaning in to hear one child read. Ask a few questions, follow up on what that student needs, keep going, and then they go to the next person. But quite literally, when I'm doing observation, I'm often keeping track of how many minutes all of the students in the classroom are actively engaged. And it's awfully nice when you can spend that length of time in a room and you don't see any behaviors that interfere with learning because kids are doing meaningful work. That captures their attention.
So what you can see going into Hopkins School is that many of these same practices that Elmwood and Center School were talking about are continued into Hopkins School. So once again, you see students working in different groupings. Here's an example of a fifth grade guided reading group, and you can see the teacher is sitting. One of the things you'll notice as you look at some of these pictures is that there's more writing incorporated. So as students move up into the upper elementary grades, the expectation in not only understanding what you read, but really writing about your reading continues to go up. And of course, we'll be talking more about SRSD, but you can see that the opportunity to be writing about what you're learning is a critical part of our Reader's Workshop as well. One of my favorite pictures is actually this one. I walked into the classroom, and these two fifth grade boys had been practicing some accuracy and fluency work. So they were practicing on some of those reading skills to become more fluent readers. And they had prepped a picture book that they were preparing to read to some center school students. So we don't have center students in our building, but with technology, we've been able to open those doorways. And for some fifth grade boys, they were so excited. They picked the book, they prepared who was going to read which pages, they practiced the reading, which builds their fluency. And then they were get prepared to talk about the story. So of course, building their comprehension. And one of the important things at Hopkins School is we really emphasize picture books. Students are very excited as they move into chapter books, and they're very excited to tell us that they read chapter books. But what we know is a lot of incredible literature is in picture book form. There's great mentor texts that use picture books to tell stories and teach themes. And you can really do a lot of rich comprehension work about text through picture books. And so for students now to be able to pull what they're learning about, all of these complex themes with a picture book, and then share it with younger children is a great way for them to practice their skills. You can see students sitting in a more typical setting here, not as much on the floor, but what you will notice as you look around is that they're very differentiated. And this is a key piece that I think the other schools have talked about as well, that students are very differentiated in their reading experience. So what one student is reading is completely different than another, based on interest, based on skill level, and individual need. We want to make sure that we're emphasizing different genres. So students are exposed to historical fiction. Are they reading fiction stories, mysteries? We want to make sure that we find things that connect with students, but we also need to make sure they're reading widely with a lot of variety. The guided reading picture really shows you how the teacher's role is really about facilitating discussion, but emphasizing individual needs. So within this group, she knows that maybe one student really needs to focus on about the text, what's happening in this text, certain inferential skills. Another student might be focusing on connecting with the text. And the job of the teacher is more a director or facilitator. Through all of our data collection that they do, as they're sitting, they have the ability to take some notes as they're listening to the students talk about their reading. That helps drive that next book. So the next time I bring a book to my group, I know that Sally needs to focus on connecting. Maybe Johnny really missed the idea of how this text feature was going to help them understand why a map would be important in this journey in a historical fiction book. So the teachers could be gathering data because they're working with small groups. That helps drive that next instructional block as they sit with students. And that's why a lot of times you'll see these groups change. As we see a need, as the information from one guided reading group is given to us through answering questions, the teacher will regroup to address needs with the next group. So a little bit more about the literacy instruction model. At Hopkins School, we really embrace the Reader's Workshop model. Students are becoming more independent, and so you'll see a lot of things happening. We've talked about these various models. We have a lot of computer-based practice. As I mentioned earlier, many students have already mastered a lot of their skills around decoding or have come very far. But we continue to, a lot of teachers use what's called CAFE, and they talk about comprehension, accuracy, fluency, and expanding vocabulary. So we continue word work, also working on perhaps spelling skills and coding skills, but building vocabulary continues to be a really important skill to develop. Understanding how to read something and what the text is asking us, understanding the vocabulary as we read. So within our Reader's Workshop, there's a lot of things happening at one time. A teacher might be working with a small group while others are working on computer-based practice for a vocabulary program. Other students might be doing paired reading, but we also do a lot of interest-based reading. So students have the opportunity to pick texts and read for enjoyment. We think that's a key piece of making sure we have active and engaged readers at Hopkins.
That would be me. Leslie Pryor, second grade at Elmwood School. I don't have a pretty slide here because this is the meat and the nitty gritty. We talked a lot about what we do in reading, and one of the most important things is to get children excited about reading and really enjoy what they're doing. But then, as parents and as teachers, we say to ourselves, how do we know they've arrived? And this is what one of the things that we do. It's called the BAS. It's an assessment system. It's systematized, and we use it in Center and in Elmwood as well. It was designed by researchers, some of the most foremost researchers right now in the field, Gay Fontes and Sue Pinnell, and they developed this by structuring a system that many of you know as a lettered spiral system, where we can use books and ask children to read to us, and we take some notes. Well, it's more involved than that. And the funny thing is, when you look at it, it's like 3.5 pages, and you say to yourselves, oh my goodness, how are the kids going to like doing this? Because it's an assessment. But believe it or not, we read with them 3 times a year in this format. We're always assessing them in some ways, daily, weekly. We can do it in a formative assessment. We sit and listen to them. We take notes all the time. This one is systematized so that we know that most teachers are doing the same thing in the same way, asking similar questions, and we're always tweaking it. But some of my kids will actually come up to me and say, I haven't had a chance to sit and read to you. They are excited to do this. It's one-to-one. They sit down, have a conference. They read a book, and their book, at this level, still has some pictures in it. Lots of rich language, vocabulary, and we have a little paper, and we read along with them. We are actually taking notes, word for word, on their fluency, on their decoding, on meaning, on how well we can understand what they're picking up, the vocabulary. We're making notes on all of these papers. We all have the same ones. And then in the end, we're looking for comprehension. And that for us, especially in second grade, is key because we have so many children that read like the wind, but how do you actually understand whether they have listened and thought about what they've read? And can they repeat it back after to you? Just as Deb had said, one of the most important things is the retelling. It's like when children come home from a movie or talk about when they went to a friend's house. Can they retell using important details? Or are they, you know, is it 5 hours long and they probably not told you a whole lot that's been very important, except that, you know, someone hit them over the head or stole their blocks or whatever. So this is an important thing when children can finally summarize and put important details together. We have a rubric that we use, and I happen to bring it because I thought it would be interesting to see. It's involved. It's this big, and not only do we assess children using this, but it also says at the bottom, well, did teacher have to ask many questions? If you've got a lot of answers, then we can move on. It kind of gives us some hints as to where we might be going with this child. And the reason why I show you this is to show you how the system is the same from grade to grade. And it's important to know that when we are asking children to tell us about books or about their reading or about their experiences, that we're all doing it in basically the same way. It's not a sit down and fill out the answer kind of test. There is a question usually at the end where we may be asking, can you tell me one important thing that you learned? But again, this is all made up by these people who have now designed this. program. And what I think is so important as teachers is that the results of these are not attached to the child as them being at one single level. Children are in ranges of levels, and I think that's the most important. They're not an L or an M. I'm sure you've heard about the letters. They're in a range of these because they may have a strength of maybe finding meaning, but maybe they have a little bit more difficulty in implicit meaning. Maybe inferencing is difficult. So they can read this L book, but can they really find what the underlying message is? Well, they can do it in the book before that, but maybe they can't quite do it here. We're taking notes all the time, and that's how we decide how we group, by skill, by development, by readiness. Another thing that is so important, because we talk about we want kids to be reading books that they enjoy, so we try to, and that they have an interest in, we try to group children by interest in our small groups, and they can be a group of two, it can be a group of five. I had a group of six. I don't think I'm going to do that again, because everyone wants to talk, everyone wants to tell you what they found, where they can find something interesting. But the small groups can really center on whatever that skill is or whatever you noticed they may need some extra help with, or they may need to dig in. And it's kind of like, I liken it to our book groups. If you're all belonging to book groups, you know what it's like. You read, you go through and ask questions that are really digging kinds of questions. What did you notice? What did you, can you prove it? Can you show me a part where? This is what is I find so important about reading and yet still make it enjoyable because they all want to talk. So that part of this type of system is good for us because it is so consistent. What we do in our guided reading groups then is we plan for our next day after we've had these tests. We take these tests in fall, winter, and at the end of the year to see some growth, to see patterns, and we pass these on from teacher to teacher. But on a daily basis, I've noted for my stickies, we're taking notes. I noticed they have trouble with that vocabulary, and I noticed that, you know, this one needs a little bit more help with informational, doesn't recognize table of contents. So you constantly group those kids together by that kind of skill. So assessment is interesting and different than it was, as we said, years ago. You know, you try, you would test the kids, maybe a multiple choice, it could be a fill in the blank, and that was it, they were labeled. It's not like that. It's fluid and it's always moving. And it really helps us decide what the next day, the next week, or I'm noticing that they're really enjoying nonfiction, or they're not getting nonfiction. Let's do more with it. And the most important thing, I think, is to find the materials that meet their needs. And that is quite a challenge, because some children have difficulty reading, but their minds are so fertile that you want to be able to spark that, but yet also try to assess where they're at. They can't decode that well, but boy, can they listen. Can they read with that partner and glean a lot of information? So that's our part of the common assessment, which really is quite helpful, and it isn't anywhere near as dreadfully scientific as it sounds, but it's so helpful for us. I feel so much better when I'm finished. I have a goal, a new goal that I can set for the next day, for the next few weeks. It's an important part of teaching, and it doesn't take away from the fun at all. As I said, begging to read with me, I have no idea why. So that's what we would do at second grade, but it is probably mostly true of all elementary, right?
Yeah, Hopkins, yeah.
All the way to Hopkins.
So we've touched upon this quite a lot already, but thinking about assessment, the key piece for me is that assessment isn't one day and then let go. Assessment is ongoing all the time in the classroom. We spoke a lot about the sticky notes, and you'll see that across the grades. We also at Hopkins continue using the BAS, and at fourth and fifth grade, we're still assessing them on their oral reading skills, their accuracy, their fluency, their oral reading rate. But the comprehension conversation, as was mentioned, is really where a lot of our work comes into play. We need to understand, do they understand about the text, within the text, beyond the text, inferential and explicit comprehension. At fourth and fifth grade, we are moving from a lot of details about the text and recall of main events, or even retelling, to really getting at much more inferential thinking about what they're reading. And this isn't a one and done thing. We're continuing to build that right into middle school. Inferential thinking skills starts really at kindergarten. We're building as soon as we're talking about books. Well, what did the author, why do you think the author wrote this book? Those skills are starting at the very beginning of reading and continue into fourth and fifth grade and beyond. So inferential thinking is something that we're analyzing and looking at all the time. How did the student do with this specific text today? What were they able to answer? What were they not able to answer? Were they able to make connections? Could they visualize the story and then tell more information? Could they understand what the meaning of the author was? So we use the comprehension conversation to help guide those next guided reading groups. And then within the guided reading groups, continuing to look at how are they doing with this text? Where do I need to tweak? And it's ongoing all of the time. Because of how long this assessment can take, obviously when you're sitting down and doing detailed analysis with students, we do it a couple times a year. At Hopkins, we also know that there's an important piece of silent reading, and how can we make sure that we're bridging into what the expectation is in middle school? We always need to be thinking ahead as what a middle school expectation on reading is going to be. And so we've introduced, we're using the QRI inventory as a group administration where students sit and read text individually by themselves and silently. Because that's a very different skill than when you're reading aloud and how you're understanding what you read there. As a group administration, students sit and read the text and then answer questions in writing. So we're again starting to bridge into the expectation about writing about their reading and doing so in a way that's really looking at how do they do with inferential questions and explicit questions. Again, most of our students are really focused on that inferential thinking. That's where the majority of Hopkins students are spending a lot of their time and instruction with their teachers. A lot of them have made good gains in explicit, the right there questions. So a lot of our work is around that other area of inferential thinking.
So then the students come to the middle school, the big bad middle school, as we're referred to sometimes, but we're really not that bad. Once at the middle school, students use, they gain all the knowledge that they gained in K through 5, and they bring it into the classroom in grade 6. The difference between elementary and middle school is elementary has a writing class and a reading class, and I believe with the SRSD they do intertwine. Same thing at the middle school, we have just an ELA block with the students, and that's where we truly combine the reading and the writing with the SRSD. And we read a lot of grade level novels. We do a lot of background information prior to reading a novel so that they gain an understanding of what happened in history before the novel took place. For example, Roll of Thunder is a sixth grade novel. We do a lot of history in some ways before we start reading the novel. So that way when we're in the novel, we can analyze the character, the protagonist, why is she feeling this way based on history that has happened in the past. So it's these deep conversations we're having with the students, really trying to get them to dig deeper with their analysis, their inferential thinking, and use vocabulary. The vocabulary in grade 6 novels can be challenging for some students, so we're using the vocabulary in our reading, our writing, our speaking, so that they're using it as often as they can. And we also, like Carrie said earlier, the nonfiction reading we do often in ELA, as well as our academic classes, our content level classes, the science, the social studies, and the math. Teachers all really try to use any kind of text features that they can and try to show them the meaning, the connection with meanings in their grade level class. I know our science teacher went to our ELA teacher just recently and said, show me how you're doing the writing piece in ELA so I can do something similar in my science class and use the same language. And we work collaboratively in groups a lot. We also adjust our practice often with the students because they're coming from different backgrounds in their reading. So we just make sure that if we're doing something for one group, we're gonna might do something different for a different group within the same classroom setting. So we really try to look at the whole group, look at their backgrounds, look at their behaviors. They're middle schoolers. They come with different kinds of, you know, social, emotional ups and downs. So we use that to help us say, okay, this is what you need help with here, and this group right here might have a better understanding, so you're going to move forward. And we adjust in many ways every single day. So.
That was a perfect unplanned transition, Ms. Chalkow. So we all know that we do our lessons and we plan our lessons with the best of intents, but sometimes, occasionally, it doesn't work out the way we want. So we have to be reflective practitioners and we have to say, what do we do if it's not working? That's what we need to do. But before we can figure out what's not working, we have to look at our kids in a bunch of different ways. You heard all about the assessments, I'm not going to talk about that. But we use those assessments and we have professional learning communities where we can look at all of this data and say, oh, yeah, I got a handful of kids that I need to pull. They just didn't do well. And I'll even extend this up to the middle school and say, in content areas, they're looking at the assessments and saying, I have this pot of kids all missed question five. I need to do some more work with this. So they're just using that data, and with that data, they're making some different decisions. So they're saying, I tried having them stay for help, I tried pulling them and doing some remediation, I tried a little extra practice, I tried, still stuck, and I'm a classroom teacher, and I'm feeling like I just need something else. So then, what's next? At that point, I look at my instructional strategies, and I reference that PLC where all the kids, our group of kids is question five. Oh, but I was talking to my friend Kathy, her kids all got that right. Well, maybe one of my strategies is we switch classes for a day. I have my friend Kathy come in and teach that because she uses different vocabulary, slightly different approach. I have to be honest enough as an educator to say what I tried didn't work, but my friend did. So I want to watch her teach that lesson and see if I can learn something different. Maybe I'm going down and I'm asking my chair, geez, do you have any strategies that you could use that you use in other places that I might be able to use today? Because I'm really, really trying and I'm not making it work. That is using some instructional strategies and going around my building and looking at my colleagues. They are the most talented pool of people I know. There's a lot of brain going on here that I can tap into when I'm stuck. I have called my colleagues at Hopkins and asked for help at times. There's a whole district of very talented people that I can reach into. And that's what we do as teachers. We start with our peers, and it's just like a ripple effect. We just go further and further. And sometimes even at that point, we say, didn't work. And at that point, I need to go to intervention. Intervention is when we look at our special staff. We're special. We could look at our reading specialist, our math specialist, our literacy coaches, and in some ways, we can use our special educators without being part of the special education process. It's another tap of people that have a very specific skill set that can support us in supporting our students. And that makes the best product that we can possibly give, which is a graduate of Hopkinton Public Schools. And we will do anything that we should do as educators to make sure the kids are learning. And sometimes that's willing to say, I don't have it this time. I'm gonna go to somebody else. And I will use every strategy I have and I will go to every specialist I know to get that support.
So we talked about literacy instruction, and now we'll add the writing component. Writing is part of English language arts instruction. You've heard the SRSD, and you're probably thinking, what is that? These are strategies for teaching children to become confident, independent writers. We begin this in kindergarten. We've had professional development that has continued through the grades, so it's present in the middle school. So how wonderful is it that we're building upon strategies that children while we have many transitions with the district, build on these same strategies year to year, school to school. So it is explicit, it is direct, it is guided. In kindergarten, there's a lot of modeling. There's a lot of writing with the teacher. Children will add information. We have lots of big chart paper, and they'll work on one product together. These are some examples of self-talk. We're teaching children how to motivate themselves when they're stuck. They need to think of an idea. How do I complete this task? And here are some examples. Never give up and keep practicing. I am a problem solver. So we're teaching children to dig in deep when the going gets tough in writing. Writing can be so vast and open-ended. Where do you start? We use a lot of graphic organizers. Some of you may have seen these come home with your writing. It's to help give children a guide where to start. So we have a topic, a beginning, an end. We have segues. And obviously, we're starting very basic at the lower levels and expanding. We work on opinion writing, even in kindergarten. And you might think, my goodness, but didn't your child learn no? Wasn't that one of their first words? That's an opinion. So we start very basic and expand our work. We certainly do. Jen's going to talk a little bit about some writing she has with her students. Yes.
Thank you. So this is one of my favorite parts of the day. In first grade, this is actually the very same student. This is the little boy in the fall, and this is him just a few weeks ago. Like Lauren said, it's a very direct approach, and there's a lot of structure to it. I mean, I remember getting a creative writing assignment in high school or even in middle school, thinking, I don't know how to write creatively. Like, where do you want me to go with this? Writing can be intimidating, especially for a developing reader, because they need to take those reading skills and apply them to their writing. So the SRSD offers a great support for them. What you don't see behind the picture here is that this lesson was all interest-based. The class was polled, and everything that we do, like with nonfiction writing, depends on their interest. We had a whole dinosaur week, and every child in the class was able to read a nonfiction selection at their level on dinosaurs. And then they were able to talk to each other about dinosaurs so they could gain some information about dinosaurs. And then we used technology in our writing so they could learn more about dinosaurs. And then we did a word splash, and we did a graphic organizer on dinosaurs. And then you can see with the amount of support that he had, look at the growth that he was able to make in just a few months. So it's pretty impressive, even what our 5 and 6 year olds can do.
Hello. So I'm Mary, I'm a learning specialist and co-teacher in third grade, and this is the second year that I've been using SRSD in my classroom, and I have to say, as a teacher, I really love it. I love the mnemonic devices that are in it. Each unit has different mnemonics that the kids learn and incorporate. They include motion and color, and it just is very engaging for the kids. What you see here are two of the components that we use in SRSD. The first is the student is color coding text, and there's really two ways we use color coding. And the first is when you're introducing a unit and you're looking at exemplars. And we color code the text to see all of the different parts of a good piece of writing. So for example, in an informative piece of writing, there's at the top usually is green, that's your topic introduction section. The details that come from the text are in yellow. Detailed examination would be in orange, and then at the end you'd see the ending sentences. It really brings a nice visual aspect to writing, which kids don't usually have. The second way you use color coding is in their own text. So now they're the writer, and they color code their own text to see, do I have the topic? Do I have the details from the text that I need? One big change about this writing program for us as teachers is that it explicitly ties writing to reading. The kids are writing based on reading every time. So they really have to get these skills of pulling the information that they need, and only what they need, from the text to write about it. This other section here, this other little guy here, he's got a rubric and then also a rocket. And these are two different ways that the kids can score their writing. Now, scoring is actually, this rubric, you can't quite see it, but there's actually three ways that we score it. The teacher has a column, so we can score the writing and reflect with the student. The students learn how to critique another peers' writing and have a peer critique them. And then there's also a column for the student to critique their own writing. And this can be such a powerful tool. It's a little intimidating for them at first. There's like 20 different things that they have to look for. But once they get used to using it, I'll tell you a story. I have a student this year. In the beginning of our informative writing, that she wrote about ants. And she thought she had like nailed it. She thought it was awesome. And we went through the narrative, or the informative writing unit, and at the end of it, we did a writing on Martin Luther King Jr. And then we compared their rubrics. And she went from 8 out of 20 on her first rubric to 17 out of 20 on her last rubric. And she was blown away how much better it was. And on these rubrics, they find opportunities, they see what they do good, and they find opportunities for what they can do better. And at the bottom, they write a goal. This is what I'm going to work on next time. And for one student, they want to work on their bold beginning. For someone else, they want to work on complex sentences, using more linking words. So all by itself, the kids are working on their own things that they need to improve. I love this program. I'm happy to use it as a teacher. It's engaging for the kids. They like it too. So
this is another example of growth. And if you think back in your mind about that kindergarten picture, this is a second grade. So the one on the left is second grade, an opinion writing prompt in the fall of second grade. And the example on the right is a posting, it's a post writing prompt, and that was a couple of weeks ago, I think, right in the middle of January. And so certainly you can pull out that the most recent writing sample is longer. But longer doesn't always mean better, and students are taught that it's not just about the length of your piece, but the things that you're including in it. And what Mary described was that kids are taught to take a peek at this. If you imagine that little boy with the rocket and the rubric, that's not the person that wrote this, but this child used similar tools to say, do I have a good beginning? Do I have a solid ending? Am I making connections? And some of the spelling is not spectacular, but the child is using his phonemic awareness to put his thoughts down on paper. And what stands out to me as an educator, this little person wasn't afraid. This little person didn't feel hung up by the things they don't have. They had lots of tools to empower them to put so much writing and ideas. Now, we have a little, the reason that the title looks strange is that the child's name was on the title. So I invited this little person down to my office today, and we talked about maybe writing a title that was not his name, so that it wouldn't be in our slide. And so we had an opportunity, he and I, to talk, and we had the pages side by side. And he, again, like Mary's student, spent a lot of time talking to himself with me about how great this was. Do you see this, he said, and do you see that? And what I thought the end was at the bottom of the page, but this story actually went on to the back, which I hadn't noticed when I submitted it. But there's more to it, to this writing. And so one of the things that stands out for me is when we were bringing SRSD to Hopkinton, we started slowly, we started in stages, it started at Center, and then it came to Elmwood, and then we were talking about let's get this to Hopkins. And a group of middle school teachers wanted to see SRSD and write in action. And we invited them to Elmwood School. And after about 20 minutes, the middle school teachers, you know, came over to me and said, if this is what they're doing in second grade, imagine the impact this will have when these same students get up to the middle school. So I think that the fact that we're continuing our learning right through the grades and moving this all forward with similar language and expectations, I think it's really exciting what student potential might be.
So this is the first year that Hopkins has had SRSD, and it's been a great addition to our writing instruction at Hopkins and really all of our literacy instruction. Certainly you can look and see that the length of writing has increased, but the detail of their writing is the big increase we see here. We, again, know we need to bridge that gap into middle school, and so thinking about content area, a lot of our work in writing and SRSD has actually expanded into, say, social studies. So, for example, fifth graders, as they're reading about explorers that are studying about explorers. They might be immersed in some primary sources, some actual writing by an explorer, and then having to analyze what's the reason that this explorer was writing this letter, who were they writing it to, and using that analysis and synthesis of what they've read to write and respond about in writing. So we have a couple examples here of Reader's Workshop and then other samples from other places in the curriculum. This is Dorothy, I think, in The Wizard of Oz. But I think the key piece here is it doesn't just live with a book in English class. We want to expand that out so that it's with nonfiction text, thinking about expanding it into social studies, even ways of bringing it into science with informational text and responding in that way. So SRSD, one of the things that I love about it is it's the common language. So in the past, you would see one teacher using one kind of graphic organizer. They get up to fourth grade and it might be a totally different graphic organizer. Now we know that all of our students are arriving at fourth grade and they have that common language, whatever of the 12 classrooms they go into in fourth grade. And then when they get into fifth grade, we mix them up again, but we're using that same language, which gives us the ability, once they get into sixth grade, that they've had many years of practice with the same terminology. We spend a lot more time on detailed examination, and as it was said, as being a former middle school teacher, thinking about how often we're talking about, okay, we take the text and we need to explain what that text is about. We're doing that down in kindergarten now. So by the time they get into fourth and fifth grade, we're doing it with potentially a story that's at a fifth grade level. By eighth grade, they're going to be doing that with To Kill a Mockingbird. So they're going to be taking text and doing detailed examination with harder text. So we keep increasing the level of text complexity, but at fourth and fifth grade, they might be reading Number of the Stars and thinking about text complexity there and writing about it. But they're still following the same learning structure and using the same strategies.
So I think what we've been able to demonstrate tonight is that we start with a lot of hands-on teacher demonstration in the early years. In some cases, these things happen within a classroom, and in some cases, these things happen from school to school. But learning for students starts with a teacher demonstrating it, and the teacher is modeling, here's how we do this. Then there's a lot of we do it together. Teachers and students are working together. Then the teacher kind of hands it off to the student, and student groups are collaborating on work. And finally, our goal for all of our kiddos is, now you're ready to do it alone. I think this is our final slide.
I'll just be brief. When you think about how you can support your kids as readers and writers at home, the most important thing is to talk to them. Talk to them about what they're reading and writing in school, and then, of course, just encourage them at home to read, and read more. What they're reading, it's not that important. If they want to read a magazine, subscribe to a magazine. Let them read that. Let them get informational text off the internet. Wherever their interests lie are the things that you want them to go towards to read. What we know is the more time they read, the better they get. And that's really what you want to just use as your kind of cornerstone at home of, I need to get them reading. Sometimes it could just be reading together. Even as they get older, continue that. Sometimes those are some of the best memories that we have. And then, of course, just continuing to talk with them about books and connections that you have with them.
And you can see why I was so excited to have all these wonderful educators here tonight. We want to leave time for questions. For those of you who did brave the elements and you're here in our audience tonight, I don't know, and your question can be posed to anybody here that is here on our panel on any of the topics that we covered tonight or even something that you might be curious about, wanting to learn more about. So, does anybody want to start us off?
Step up to the mic. step up to the mic? If anybody has a question, that is. There's one right behind you. Thank you.
First of all, I just want to say thank you because clearly expertise, passion, commitment, incredible. And my question is more of a curious one.
Great.
So I have sons that are in seventh, sixth, and fourth. And I want to ask about how summer reading lists are chosen and when they're, are they looked at each year and thought about, so I don't know if there's any.
Okay, who would like to take that? Carrie, I was looking at you.
I know.
Come on up.
It's a very short answer.
I can tell you that right now the middle school has put, the middle school English Language Arts Department has put together a staff survey, and we're looking at revamping the summer reading, and they are looking for feedback from students and staff on the novels that we've currently been using, and since you mentioned two of them, I think I understand. So, but this is live, so we're just being live here. I'm wondering from parents, so I just asked quickly if there were any recommendations at the elementary level. Do you see summer reading lists that are posted somewhere? Or are you asking that there be some?
No, well, there's, I think there's just a number for the earlier grades, right. But then once you get into middle school, there's assigned reading.
Yes.
There's
yes.
Assigned texts.
Do any of the teachers feel that they want to comment on this, on whether or not this should be something that we think about doing, or Leslie?
Just one thing, I do know that several of the teachers in the elementary school will send home lists of books of interest for children. I think that's very important to have for parents as well, and also what are appropriate books at what grade level, because it's very hard to go into a bookstore or a library or wherever and know exactly what's a good match for your child. So I do know that that does occur in many classrooms. I know I send home a lot of lists on paper. Now that I'm thinking about it, I could actually do it digitally. So maybe I'll move on to that, but it seems to be taken, you know, really well by parents, and I know I liked it when I had younger kids. So we don't have to's, but it's great to get something that the kids can do during the summer and enjoy. And I kind of categorize them by, not only the topic, but genre, you know, dogs, animals, whatever. So I think that's helpful, and I know I'm not alone.
Thank you. And in addition, I'll just add, I was just going to say to think about also Deb's comment about it's not so much what they're reading, but just that they are reading. Is that what you want to add?
Yeah, so for Central School, we don't have prescribed lists for kindergarten and first graders over the summer. We want you to read a variety of materials, be it brochures for vacation, maps, magazines. We encourage you to join, participate in the library program. Public Library has a wonderful reading program. Children are there listening to stories. It's theme-based over the summer and having the opportunity to select books and bring them home. Children will check out books that you must read because they cannot read on their own. They will check out books that they can read on their own. So having that wide variety of exposure to text builds their comprehension. It's okay they choose books they can't read on their own because you will model fluency, you will build comprehension. We might have suggestions of authors that children may enjoy, but we don't have a prescribed list. We really want you to foster the love of learning with our young literacy learners.
Thank you. Anything else that's on your mind? If not, right this moment, live, on your mind, I welcome any feedback, any emails to myself or Dr. Cavanaugh. We'll get them to the right person. Any requests for additional information that we didn't cover tonight, or information that you want about your own student, we would be happy to answer any of those through email is probably the best way. But again, thank you, HCAM, for filming this live. Thank you to all of our presenters that are here tonight, and thank you in our audience for coming out.